Welcome to the J&J Wrestling Podcast with your host, James Pritzky.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the J&J Wrestling Podcast here on YouTube and Facebook. If you haven't seen it, ladies and gentlemen, the message is clear. Change. You've seen it on my Facebook page since Thursday. Actually, since Wednesday. I posted, change is inevitable. Change is coming. Change is here. Rocksteady is here, ladies and gentlemen. It has happened. The change has been complete. PWE has changed over to Rocksteady Wrestling. And here to talk about it from Outbreak Entertainment is the reigning, I guess we should say former PWE champion, now reigning Rocksteady Wrestling heavyweight champion, the incomparable Marc Mandrake. Marc, welcome back to the podcast. It's number three for you, brother.
Thanks, James. I appreciate it. Yeah, this one, it's going to be a little bit different this time for me, because now we're kind of, you know, like I said, when Outbreak reached out to you, you didn't necessarily know it was me, and we wanted to actually focus on a more business aspect of it than than Mark, you know, Marc Mandrake, the Suicide Messiah, the wrestler. You know, this is going to be more of a business aspect. So,
and we're looking forward to it. And then we're going to talk about all different things in regarding to what Outbreak wants to accomplish in regards to their company, and that would be stuff like wrestling, of course, because we're going to talk about that. This is a wrestling podcast.
Yes.
So we're going to definitely talk about that. But we're going to also talk about other podcasts joining the network as well. We're going to be talking about film. We're going to be talking about music. And, of course, we'll talk about as much music as we can because a lot of that is tight-lipped. But we're going to definitely get into it, and we're going to talk about it right here and right now. Last night, we had an incredible show. Ricky the Dragon Steamboat was present. As always, he is a man's man. WWE Hall of Famer is definitely genuine and kind, and we definitely appreciate having him on the show. He is definitely the legend that he truly is. I remember his match with Ricky the Dragon Steamboat. With Randy Savage. Oh, my goodness. I'm flubbing my lines already, man. we're excited here. Ricky the Dragon Steamboat and Randy Savage had the incredible match at WrestleMania 3 that people still talk about today, calling it the best match in WrestleMania. And, of course, then there's the trifecta with the Nature Boy Ric Flair over the World's Heavyweight Championship. And again, later on in 1994, one of my favorite matches that Ricky the Dragon Steamboat had with Ric Flair over the WCW Heavyweight Championship. And then to come back years later after a near career-ending back injury. Actually, it was career-ending. He came back in 2009 and had two incredible matches with Chris Jericho. A class act indeed. Always welcome into Outbreak, of course.
Yes, we were very excited that Ricky the Dragon Steamboat was coming in. I mean, as a kid, I remember watching his match with Savage at you know, for WrestleMania 3. We were at a friend's house, and his kids, because of all the near falls, you know, it was kind of like every time we were on the edge of the edge of our seats on the couch. Ooh, yes! Oh, yes! Oh, yeah! So
27 near falls in that match.
Yes, it ranks up there as one of my top five favorite matches of all time.
So we definitely thank the Dragon for joining us last night. Also last night, things changed.
Yes.
As it has to happen, and it did. We're now Rocksteady Wrestling.
Yes.
Let's talk about how that came about, my friend.
All right, well, to do that, we kind of have to go back. I'm going to explain a little bit about Outbreak first, because it's all going to make sense and tie together. I'm going to try to make a long story as short as possible. Outbreak Entertainment was started by Ferrari or Danielle, you know, and myself as a entertainment company. We did not have any intentions really of running wrestling. That was never our intent. We wanted to stick primarily with music and film. I grew up in the music industry, and I have quite a bit of background in film, so it made sense. And Danielle went to school initially for music. I forgot what degree it was that she initially was going for, and then she decided she liked animals better than musicians, which I think are almost the same thing sometimes. What had happened out of that is we were focusing on that. And then Nick Hansberry had booked me to wrestle on the PWE show in November. And I had watched kind of from an outsider's point of view of what was going on. And I finally approached him because I had known Nick for a long time. And I was like, Nick, this is not going the right way. I mean, if you go this way, you're not going to last longer than a couple shows. There were some things that just, and it wasn't, you know, again, he Nick is a good kid. You know, he started out as a fan, and he did start training a little bit under Vito LaGrasso to wrestle. I don't know exactly what happened out of that. I believe he got injured, and that's why he couldn't finish his training, but he still wanted to be involved with wrestling. So I did try to take him under my wing a little bit and help him out, because I do have, you know, a good amount of experience, and was trained by, you know, one of the best in the business as far as backstage stuff. You can't really, you know, do much better than learning from Off of the Wild Samoan. And that's who I learned a lot from. So I helped him out, and what had happened was there was certain things that Nick just, he wasn't necessarily getting. And after the last show in March, I was so frustrated that, as a matter of fact, I believe when I stormed out at the end of the night, I even looked at you. I'm like, F it, I'm done. And finally, you know, and I'm sure we'll probably get into the reasons why I didn't quit. But we sat back and we looked at the whole situation. We looked at what Nick was doing, what he wasn't doing, what he brought to the table, what he didn't bring to the table. We also looked at the potential for us to grow. Mm-hmm. And we seen some of the avenues that were available for us to move in a positive direction where we can grow and reach what our end vision is. Because there is an end goal to this. I can't really get into it, but we do have a vision of where we want to go with this. And for us to do that, unfortunately, we had no other choice. We had to change. We had to have people step aside or step back or step away that may not have worked. And unfortunately, you know, Nick prided himself on being the CEO of PWE Wrestling. And that's not really what Outbreak's about. Outbreak is about being a team. And being able to cover for each other if something happens. You know that we've dealt with the podcast, mm-hmm. you know, and you recently had a health incident, and I told you, look, take care of that. We'll take care of the podcasts as it comes along. If that means we have to do two in 1 week or what have you, mm-hmm. we'll do that, you know, but you had our backs and we had yours. And again, in the big picture, your health was more important to me than the podcast. Mm-hmm. So at any rate, what had happened was, is we'd see no advertising. There was very little communication between Nick and Outbreak. He did communicate a little bit with Vince, Don Vincenzo, and Vince, because Vince is a very important part of Outbreak, along with Danielle, me, yourself, because we have different divisions of it, which I'm sure we'll get into. Mm-hmm. And it just, after seeing that he wasn't pulling his weight, we had no other choice. We had to make a decision. Now, Rocksteady Wrestling was never meant for something for Florida. It was not. It was something that we were going to do in New York. Mm-hmm. New York primarily, but that also, I mean, we were looking at Canada as well, Pennsylvania, West Virginia, all areas that, you know, we
you traveled up and down the roads in those areas, but in the beginning of your career.
Yes. And I mean, I'm originally from New York, so... Getting, you know, I already have the license. I have the ring. I have a venue that's like, yeah, definitely, we'll do it. And I also have, because it was going to be wrestling and bands, and we were mm-hmm. going to run shows with both. And I have several different bands that were jumping to do it, one of which is one of the most popular bands up there that, I mean, they do 80s cover tunes, but they draw close to, you know, I think it was 1,000 to 1,500 every show that they do, and they do about 3 shows a week. Mm-hmm. They're incredibly popular.
I grew up with 80s music for the most part. Going into, you know, I'm a 79 baby. 80s music was a big thing, and of course, the late 80s and the 90s, so...
Yeah, and there was an opportunity there, and then once things did not go quite the way we were hoping with Nick, we sat down and after some turmoil, which I'm sure we'll get into, we finally decided, okay, look, we got to make a change. If we're going to do this, we got to make a change, and it was decided at that point that, you know what, Rocksteady Wrestling might be something that we can do down here. Are we going to be able to include bands in it right away? No, the music scene is drastically different in Florida than it is in other areas of the country.
And that's not just music. We're talking about wrestling's a lot different down here in Florida. Even MMA is a lot different down in Florida.
So, oh, definitely.
And that's something you'll get to touch on, and we'll talk about that a little bit in the future. But, you know, it's a lot different down here. It's not – everybody compares it to we are the southern part of the Northeast, but reality, it's a different animal on its own right down here.
Yes. Yes, it is. And that's the thing. We've seen an opportunity with Rocksteady Wrestling. We've seen an opportunity to grow. We've seen the potential for to generate more revenue and go the direction that we wanted to go, where everybody would be on the same page. Again, I stress team over and over and over again. You know this because me and you talk a lot.
Right. We talk a lot. We talk with George Martel,
yes,
who's looking to do his podcast with us. We'll get more into that in a few moments here. Of course, Danielle's a huge part in that. I think she's the glue, I would like to say, of the outfit. But as you said, it's all about being a team.
Yes. The team aspect is so incredible. Look, we've had a rash of injuries, you know, with the wrestling promotion, whether you want to call it, you know, the old PWE, Rocksteady, what have you. We've had a rash of a couple injuries, you know, and personnel-wise, you know, I have, you know, a family member that got some bad news, and I let you guys know, look, you guys might have to cover for me for a couple things. Mm-hmm. You had a health scare, you know, but the same thing remained constant. And one of the things that we've heard from people is, you know, especially some of our wrestlers, and you yourself have said it, you know, I care more about your health and your well-being, because business, we can always cover for that. And that's one of the things as a team we do. We make sure we can all cover for each other just in case. And that's something that Danielle and I, especially when we first started that was one of the things that we both said. We have to make sure that everybody works as a team because,
right,
again, you know, and I'm going to probably totally misquote this. What was it? A village raises a child or something like that. Somebody mentioned that to me a long time ago,
yes,
but it's true.
Yes.
And we kind of go by that mentality. It's like, look, you know, business is very, very important.
It takes a village to raise a child.
Yes, that's what it is. I knew I was close. I messed things up. Hey, you know, how many spoilers have I leaked on your show in the past? You know, I mess things up all the time, but the fact is it's very important, and we stress that all the time, and you know, we're there for each other, and that's important.
One of the things you mentioned that on the end of PWE3, you almost called it quits.
Yeah.
And about a couple weeks after that, you attended the wedding of the Brooklyn Juggernaut Romeo.
Yes.
And a lot of the talent was at that wedding, all friends of the Brooklyn Juggernaut, and all of them came up to you and mentioned to you that you are the driving force between PWE, and they were loyal to you. It was almost like a solidarity thing. They appreciated what you were going to do for them and looking out for their best interest. And that's a lot of the reasons why guys like ERA I think this is mostly Stress ERA, who has been going through some new changes in his own life, is coming up from all the way from South Florida to be at our show.
Yes.
Guys like Adi, okay, who's about ready to get into the big leagues here very soon. He's got it all put together, but he trusts your judgment, and he will be at our show. I'm not just talking about on the show per se, okay? We're hoping he's going to be cleared for the next show, okay, which is coming up in June.
Yes.
But he's behind you because he supports you, and you support all your talent, and yes. You let everybody know that, and they have a vote of confidence for you. And that is one of the reasons why you are still doing wrestling, because you said flat out, I don't need wrestling.
No, honestly, wrestling is not a lucrative business. It the revenue generated by wrestling, you know, it's funny. You go and you tell people, oh, you know, what do? Oh, I wrestle professionally. Oh, and then they think we're rich. No, are you kidding me? I wish. I made more money in music than I ever made in wrestling, but. That being said, when I was ready to quit, and when a number of those guys came up and talked to me and said, look, they've got my back no matter what we do, just keep them in the loop. And then, like for example, with ERA, ERA recently did move down to South Florida. And, my question to him wasn't, hey, can you make the next show? It had nothing to do with the show. My question to him is, hey, are you okay? Is there anything that I can help you with? And, because that's how we feel about all of our wrestlers, and that's how we approach it. And the interesting thing that he came back to me is I was the only promoter / booker or what have you that actually cared more about his well-being and his family's well-being than, hey, can you make the next show? Mm-hmm. I've told guys before, look, we can work around if you can't make the show. That's not a problem. What's more important to me is that you're okay and you're healthy and you're not injured, you're safe and mentally that you're okay. Because that is the most important thing. And when those guys stood behind me like that, I remember going home from the show, from the wedding, and I looked right at Danielle and I'm like, you know what? As much as I want to quit this, I can't. I too many people are counting on us, and I feel like I have to be loyal to them.
But it's not just wrestling that's going to be happening here. We're talking about our podcasts here, especially this one. The J&J Wrestling Podcast is a huge supporter of Outbreak Entertainment, now a partner of Outbreak Entertainment.
Yes.
We're going to have a new co-host coming up in July, and we're going to have a rebranding of sorts. But we're going to still talk about independent wrestling. We're going to still talk about WWE. We're going to still talk about AEW, as much as you have some conspiracy theories about that, we'll definitely have to have you on the show just for those, in fact. But definitely their Double or Nothing card is coming up in mere days. I think in a couple weeks, actually. Money in the Bank's coming up next weekend.
Yes.
So we're definitely, maybe we'll touch on that near the end of the show here. But nevertheless, you're going to have a podcast that we're going to be debuting sometime in July. We're hoping for International Fight Week.
Yes.
Talk about MMA, UFC in particular. I know you're looking at some other promotions that you might want to elaborate on for a moment here.
Yeah, obviously, UFC is the most popular one, but I mean, we would like to give some exposure to, Bellator. A number of people know about Bellator as well, but we also want to look at getting exposure to other promotions. Invicta, which is an all women's MMA promotion, is actually really good, and a lot of the women that you see in UFC came out of Invicta. Mm-hmm. One Championship Fighting, they're out of Singapore. They're actually very unique in how they work, and we'll get into that. There is a Professional Fighting League that's on ESPN. They just got a deal with ESPN. I believe they were NBC before. And there's a couple other ones as well. And it's because, you know, and we also are planning on, hopefully, covering some local MMA shows within the Florida area to kind of hopefully expose some younger talent, some younger fighters to the fans so they can watch out for them. Because these guys, you're going to see them in UFC someday. You know, and so it's important to get to know some of their names and stuff like that. So I'm very excited about it. I mean, I've said before, I mean, yes, I love wrestling, but if you offer me tickets to a WWE pay-per-view or you offer me tickets to a UFC pay-per-view, give me the UFC tickets any day of the week.
The only exception to that will maybe be April 5th.
Maybe. It all depends, maybe.
WrestleMania. We'll see what happens by then. I know we're all talking about WrestleMania because it's in our backyard this year coming up in 2020. So we're looking forward to that, of course. As we had mentioned, George Martel, we've been talking about bringing his podcast in with some of his life experiences.
Yes. George is a very unique individual. I know George very well. He really is like a brother to me. He managed me for a little while in ACW when we were in the New Movement. But the awesome thing about George is he's related to Rick the Model Martel. He also is related to Frenchie Martin. And he grew up around a lot of the stories that we hear. He was living in Puerto Rico at the time when Bruiser Brody was unfortunately murdered. He has some awesome stories that he may be able to tell about that. I know with the Bruiser Brody murder, a lot of people are very quiet about it. It's a very touchy subject. Mm-hmm. But there's so many awesome stories that he can tell from his experiences. And he also tries to, and this is going to go into the video portion of the podcast that I'm trying not to spoil. But there's pictures that he has of him as a little kid sitting on like Hogan's lap and sitting on Andre's lap and things like that. I mean, he grew up backstage at most of these shows when we were kids, mm-hmm. that we would go to. He was backstage with all this stuff.
Right.
And he shares all those experiences, you know, via his podcast. So we are working on trying to get that arranged. We're close to getting that sealed up. Not quite there yet, but we're really close, and I feel really confident that we're going to have that on the Outbreak Podcast Network soon as well. And there's a couple other things that we're looking at, too. I'm looking at a music podcast dealing with musicians and things like that that hopefully we can bring on board as well.
Right.
But again, these are, you know, some things are solid. You know, you're solid. Yep. The MMA podcast, that's solid. The George Martel one is real close to being solid. The other ones are pretty close, but, you know, we're still working on it, so I don't want to totally let the cat out of the bag on those.
Sure, absolutely. And we talked about film, indeed, and one of those things is the fact that those very podcasts may actually be on film. We're going to actually record them, and we're going to have our faces planted right out there. I have a pretty gorgeous face, you know, for a 400-pounder.
That's right, and I don't.
Well, if we ever have to title us being on the same show there, Mark, we'll just go with Beauty and the Beast, okay?
That's right. That'll work.
I'm actually looking to, as I said, change the podcast to fit thing. I kept the J&J Wrestling Podcast. My old partner, James Ludeman, did move up to Excel to continue his work with the Lord, and we do appreciate that. But he even told me himself he's getting the bug, and I told him, well, you know what, we can always Skype you in, my friend. We will do that at sometime soon. We were hoping to Skype him in last week. Unfortunately, some time constraints ran into him not being on the show, but nevertheless, very soon, as I said, matter of fact, my new co-host is quite nearby. Would you like to say hello, Ferrari?
Hello, Ferrari.
We have some ideas, and obviously we're going to go ahead and lay them out for you soon, and we're hoping for July. Is that correct?
That's what I was told just yesterday.
I'm sorry. We're making plans for the quote unquote boss.
I'm excited and flattered, and I'm really looking forward to what we're gonna do.
So. Well, you know, one of the things that I mentioned, and if you can just excuse me for a moment while I go ahead and pull up, I'm gonna actually do the old fashioned quote unquote. You won't be able to see me doing it, but I will definitely quote unquote what I have to say here. If you bear with me here. I'm looking forward to having you on as a co-host because, number one, you have 15 years plus in this business. So having somebody with that behind me is going to be a godsend. So that's going to be wonderful. But here we are. I spoke to you earlier.
Yes. Oh, I know what he's going to talk about. Yep.
I spoke to you earlier, and what I said to you was this. I said that I was going to have an indie legend lined up named Ferrari on the podcast as my co-host. And you laughed at me, of course, and then came and said, how many women can bleed like you do? Now, of course, with that said, you listed one right off the bat.
Luffy, Mephisto, yes. Yeah.
And then you mentioned a bunch in Japan, but ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to say right off the record here, if George Martel is on the board here, he likes to talk about Japan wrestling as well. So that's something we could definitely bring into that one. But nevertheless, as my niece just came out and blurted out, Japanese wrestling. New Japan, always wonderful. But All Japan had a whole entire women's group back in the day too. But very few can bleed like you. So therefore, yes, you are an indie legend. And we want to bring that knowledge here on the J&J Wrestling Podcast, or whatever we got to call it very soon. Have some ideas, and we will get to that. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a quick break here, and then when we come back, we're going to do something that many people have talked about doing, but very few. Matter of fact, I'm willing to say probably nobody has ever done. We're going to dive into the head of the Suicide Messiah. We'll be right back here on the J&J Wrestling Podcast. Welcome back to the J&J Wrestling Podcast. I want to take a moment to thank everybody for their support. I did have surgery a little over two weeks ago. Had my gallbladder removed and the tremendous pain I had, and I do apologize. I was able to miss 1 week. Of course, as we know, our health is the most important thing in the world. And I want to thank for all the support. I know the ERA sent messages. I had a message from Ativalu, which is very uncharacteristic because I didn't understand one word of it because it was a Samoan. But nevertheless, I did translate it, and it did not mean he was going to kill me. So that's a good start right there. TV Justin Michaels, despite the fact that he made fun of me about the barbecue that was coming down my chin when we had the bar our podcast, he just sent a message hoping I would get well. And it's just amazing the brotherhood of the locker room of wrestling, that they all band together. I want to thank Joe Abel for his reaching out to me. I know he's going through some serious issues right now. We want to send our best to Joe Abel. We will get him on the show, and we will definitely get talking about Fighting for a Cure 6. That is July 28th in Sarasota, Florida. And the WWE Hall of Famers Rocky Johnson and Mick Foley will be there as part of that show. We'll have a shout out to Joe and get well. But I want to talk about the two most important folks that reached out to me during my injury, during my surgery, I should say. And that this really solidifies what Outbreak Entertainment is about when it comes to family atmosphere. It wasn't about, are you going to be ready for May 11th? And I was. Thank God. Originally, we were thought my scheduled surgery to get this removed was going to be in that time frame, and emergency surgery happened, and we weren't sure what was going to happen for May 11th. I was proud to be there, and that was the most important thing. I want to tell you something right now. It was a pleasure, because not many people on the outside get to be able to stand inside the Holy Grail of that squared circle. I've only been in a squared circle one time, and that was because I paid $1,500 to go to WWE Performance Center for All Access and got to have ring announce two matches, and it was really awesome, and it was a pleasure to do that. It was a pleasure to be inside the same ring with my guest, the reigning Rocksteady Wrestling Champion, Marc Mandrake, who called on me just about every day, just to check to see how I was doing. I really appreciate it from the bottom of my heart that you were able to reach out to me every single time. I'm going to have weight loss surgery coming up soon.
And I'm sure I'll reach out to you every day with that, too. Absolutely. Your health is more important than anything else.
Yeah, and I'm going to be 40. I'm going to be 40 this year. And when it comes down to it, I'm a 400-pound man, and I've tried things to get down my weight down. With some success, but then there's also some failure. And you know what? You learn from things and you have to move on. Some things just aren't meant to happen naturally, and we're going to have a doctor to help you out with it. And we're looking forward to this change. I've talked to many people who have had this surgery successfully, and I didn't even know it, which was amazing to know this. So it's definitely given me some hope to get back to where I was before I quit smoking. I'm 10 years putting down the nicotine, and I'm very happy for that because I lived longer because of that. But now I have the issue of getting down to size. So we're going to definitely get that worked on, and we'll continue support from all the fans and, of course, from all the performers that I work with. It's definitely a tremendous family. And with that said, let's talk about my actual family. My niece was at the show on Saturday, as well as my mother, who presented a beautiful blanket that will remember where the beginnings of this company has come from. And remember that we were PWE in the beginning, and it will be forever etched in history that this was where we started. And we're going to continue on the legacy. I'm sure eventually we might be able to get a Rocksteady blanket, but we're going to take our time on that one. it was just been a great knowing that, you know, you have family behind you, and that was the most important thing in the world. So
definitely. And we're very appreciative to your mom for the PWE blanket. And history is incredibly important to remember because it does. It leaves a legacy behind it. And PWE was the start of all of this, and there's no taking that away. There's no denying that, and it's very important that we remember where we came from. I always feel strongly you always remember your roots and where you came from.
Real quick, I want to just track back. I'm sure most people do know this, but I want to talk about who is behind most of the creativity of the Rocksteady, PWE before that. And that was you, my friend. You are a lot of the thought and process that goes behind this. You're not only the creative, but you're the booker. I mean, we've talked for hours about how we could make things better. I mean, a lot of it is throwing it up against the wall and see what sticks, and it falls off, it falls off. You know, we talked about what you said, what could become, what's gold, what's silver, and what's
crap.
Yeah, there you go. I'm stealing your line here, okay? But nevertheless, we have this discussion for hours about what would be best for our fans.
Yes. The fans come first, and that's incredibly important. I say that before every show, and we encourage all of our wrestlers to interact with the fans, because if there was no fans, wouldn't be doing this. Yeah. There'd be no wrestling. So it's, you know, from a creative standpoint, you know, I sit back and I look at who's available for the shows, and you know, we try to plan ahead as much as we possibly can, and we look at matchups, and again, you know, this is something that you know is very popular with MMA, but styles make matchups. And I believe you mentioned before we went on the air about ERA and Sideshow.
Those two had amazing matches, two amazing matches back in January at the second event.
Yes.
And then, of course, in March, they stole the show yet again. Matter of fact, in January, their position on the card kind of made the main event look very weak.
Yeah, well, you know, again, here's the thing. We all make mistakes, and sitting back and thinking about it, I would change where they were on the card. I wouldn't have put them where they were. I would have separated the two. I do think it hurt the main event. But again, it's look, no matter what level you are in this business, whether you're at the indie level, whether you're in WWE, you know, or any place in between, sometimes you strike gold, sometimes you strike silver, and sometimes you get a pile of crap. With that, just that situation, the match itself was just amazing. Unfortunately, though, it did take away from the main event. And I don't fault those guys at all. I wanted them to go out there and I wanted them to kill it. I even told them, I go out there and kill it. Do your very best, because it's just going to make those guys in the main event try even harder. And that's exactly what ERA and Sideshow did. And I haven't hidden the fact, I've said this before on your show, ERA is one of the guys that's the future of this business. And Sideshow, I know incredibly well. It's Danielle's brother. So he's my brother-in-law. And me and him have been in the ring numerous times. I've been in the ring with ERA before shows, working out with him a little bit. So I know him incredibly well as well. And I just knew those two matchups would mesh.
And ERA, just so you know, is a class act. One of the young stars that has it put together.
Yes, definitely agree. Definitely agree. Him and Ati.
Ativalu is definitely also another. Ativalu has some big things coming up soon, and we'll get into that when the time is right, of course.
Yes.
But he definitely has some big things coming up, and we're looking forward to those as he is healing right now with his surgery he had to get done. Best of wishes to Ati and get better soon, and we want to see you in the ring again, my friend. So definitely some good things coming regarding that. Now, most characters in professional wrestling are themselves turned up to the 11th power, I guess we'll call it. And one of those characters is the Suicide Messiah. And this is very true when it comes to Marc Mandrake. Because a lot of the things that we saw in these promos in the last few weeks were the voices in the head, the isolation, all signs of mental illness. And it's time we dig into the head of Marc Mandrake. And we've had this conversation before.
Yeah, it's... you know, it's fitting that we're talking about this now because it is, you know, Mental Health Awareness Month. And I think it's important, you know, and I've said, as a matter of fact, I remember the very first time I was on your show and you guys invited me on. And I openly said, look, you can ask me any question you want. The one thing that I ask that you stay away from is anything regarding, you know, mental health or anything like that, because it was something that I really didn't want to talk about. Unfortunately, the past few months I've had a really really difficult time. I mean, some people don't realize, and I guess I'll realize now. You know, I have bipolar too, which means the depressive episodes are incredibly bad. Thankfully, I don't have the manic episodes quite as bad as anybody else. You can tell when I have a manic episode, though, because at that point, I'm up usually for like 3, 4, 5 days straight, and I'm talking your guys' ears off constantly and calling you guys at 5 o'clock in the morning.
Silence the phone. My alarm does go off. It's okay.
Yeah, you know, and it's one of those things. But again, it's... I've suffered through mental illness pretty much all my life. And, you know, over the past 5, 10 years, it's gotten worse. This time, as opposed to any other time where I would just be like, yeah, I'm just having a depressive, you know, I'm in a depressive phase, you know, or what have you. Now, this time I actually, and for the first time in my life, I actually... You know, I told you, just like I mentioned it to Danielle and even, you know, even Vince, who many know as Don Vincenzo, you know, guys, I'm sick, you know. Yep. And I've never admitted to myself or anyone else for that matter that I was sick. But I knew I was sick because the depression was 10 times worse than it usually is. The anxiety was 10 times worse than it usually is. I've had issues with hearing voices in my head, but these voices were different this time. And you know, one of the saddest parts is sitting, you know, right next to your wife when she's sleeping, playing a video game or whatever, because I don't sleep well at night anyway. That's when I'm my most creative, and feeling all alone. And there are times where I've reached out to you or I've reached out to mm-hmm. Vince, or, you know, because I don't want to wake up Danielle. I've reached out to other people. And you guys, you know, at first, you guys didn't realize it was to stop me from doing something dangerous. You guys thought it was just I want to talk about business, because I do. I focus on business constantly. But really what it was is it was me reaching out, asking for help without actually saying help, to stop me from doing something stupid. And what really told me that there was an issue, and this is something, and we've talked about this, and, you know, look, I'm going to totally screw things up for you right here, but we started recording this earlier, and we had an issue with the recording. And one of the things that I didn't tell you on this is there was a particular night where I sat there and I looked at all the medications I have. And I stopped taking them because I was frustrated, you know, after the last show. And I looked at them and I'm like, you know, what's the worst that's going to happen if I decide to take all of these pills at one time? And unfortunately, the worst thing that would happen...
You would die.
You know what, though? That wasn't the worst thing to me. The worst thing to me was that Danielle would find me dead. That was the worst thing to me. Now that I'm starting to get better, am I 100%? No. I still have issues.
You will probably never be 100% in reality.
No. So the gimmick of the Suicide Messiah, and I mentioned this to you earlier, you know, I have, you know, the voice in my head. You know, look, I try to sit here and, you know, make light of them, whatever. You know, the fact is, oftentimes they're telling me to kill myself, and I'm fighting against that, you know. And unfortunately, you know, with that, you know, you never want to feel that way. Mental illness is a very, very real thing. And you never want to get to that point where you're sick. You want to get help. And that was my problem, is because I was trying to reach out for help, but I didn't know where to reach out to, which is interesting, because I've went to school for this. I've got a master's degree in psychology. I know this stuff. I know it front and back. And I know where to reach out for help. The unfortunate thing is getting help is not always the easiest thing in the world. And it's great that they tell you if you have suicidal thoughts or what have you, to call the suicide hotline. And that's awesome, because they do great help. But as a friend, make yourself available if someone's depressed, because you're going to help them more than that hotline will be able to, because they know and they can trust you. And that was why I would reach out to other people almost asking help. It was very difficult. It was very difficult for Danielle, because she seen me go through that. There was times where she couldn't reach me. So, you know, the Suicide Messiah thing, and I'm, you know, when I was younger, there were several times that I tried to kill myself, and do I regret it? Yes, definitely. Do I thank God every day that I screwed up when I did it? Yes, I do, you know, but that's kind of where the name came from, and I never want to forget that I was in those dark moments, because I never want to be there again. Unfortunately, I know that there's going to be times where I'm there again. I know it's something I'm going to have to deal with. I know it's something that Danielle is going to have to deal with, because she has to deal with it right along with me, because she's my wife. You know, she loves me. She cares about me. You know, my friends have to deal with it. You know, it is. I mean, it's difficult for you guys sometimes to see me in the state I am, but it's unfortunately a very real thing, you know. And I'm glad we're touching on it. It is a difficult subject, and for a long time I said no. And there is more to it than just this, but it's not anything that I'm ready to get into quite yet. I did promise you that I will be more than happy to share some of those experiences. I mean, I will say some of it does have to deal with head trauma and stuff like that, because I did take a lot of chair shots over 20 years. But right now I'm not ready. I'm not prepared to talk about that yet. I did say I was willing to talk about the mental illness, because it did play into what was going on and why some of the promos were kind of rambling. And why I avoided talking wrestling with you guys for a couple months. And you knew, I mean, Danielle told you guys, look, no, he's not in the right frame of mind. So it's not like it was a surprise to you guys. You guys knew why I wasn't doing it, you know?
It's a very difficult subject to talk about. And the fact of the matter is that I realize how knowledgeable you are on this subject. I have a family member very close to me who was recently diagnosed with mental illness, as we are currently in the middle of Mental Health Awareness Month. And the first person that I called was you, for two reasons. Number one, your psychology degree, your background on the knowledge. Number two is because you've been there.
Yes.
And the thing about it is, Mark, the thing about it is that there is so much that I've learned in the last 2 weeks about how the mind really truly works and what happens when it gets sick, that I would have never known about, because I'm not a person who has studied psychology. And I'm most certainly not a person who has lived this kind of life. I'm new to this. I've had some depression in the past, but nothing like what my family member is going through. Nothing even close to what you're going through.
No, and the big thing with that is making sure that you are there. you mentioned before when we were talking, you know, you don't sympathize with them, but empathize with them. Show empathy, because and realize that, you know, and that's one of the biggest things, you know, we've come a long way in how we treat mental illness and how we look at mental illness. When I was a child, you know, and I'm kind of old, I'm kind of old, but you know, 30 years ago, 40 years ago, you know, if we'd walk and we would see someone with mental illness, you know, it would automatically be like, well, cross the street, you know, cross the street. We you know, something's wrong with him. He's crazy. Now we understand that that's not always the case. Just because someone has a mental illness does not mean that they're a bad person at all. It means that they're sick and they need help. And in that case, we need to keep that in mind. You don't see all illnesses. And mental health, one of the reasons why it was so hard to get over that stigma is because you can't see it. It's not a physical injury. And that was why it was so difficult for so many people to get over that stigma. And I think what we need to do, and that's the reason why I agreed to, you know, when we talked about what we're going to talk about today, that was the reason why I was okay with talking about this, because my hope is that it helps people that might be considering getting help. Please, please, I beg of you, get the help that you need, because you know, life is so much better when the colors are more vibrant, when you can see the sunshine. And if you're going through a time where everything's just raining down on you, understand that there is truly light at the end of that tunnel. It might feel, and it does. I'll tell you right now, it honestly, the best way I can word it, when you go through those times, it feels like you're in a toilet bowl and you're just spinning around. No matter how much you claw, you're not getting out of that. And that's what it feels like. And it feels like you're just going to drown and die. And it's one of the worst feelings in the world. And if you feel that way, please get help. There's numbers, there's resources. You know, I mean, I've always been the type of person where look, you know, yes, I might be a mean person when I have to be, you know, because that's the part that I play sometimes. But I've always told anybody, look, if you need help, if you need resources, I will get you numbers of where you can get help, you know, because the last thing I want is to hear of someone doing something harmful to themselves or killing themselves when it could have been prevented. It's a horrible feeling, and I really won't get into it right now, but I've experienced it. Almost anybody in wrestling has experienced it firsthand, but I experienced it in my own family. It's a horrible feeling, and it's something that if we can prevent it. Let's talk about it. Get it out there. Let people understand, look, this is something that we need to raise awareness about.
You mentioned that we had this recorded earlier, I saw a side of you that very few people, and I do stress, very few people, like really outside of your wife and Vince, have ever seen, and that's tears in your eye. Yep. Because of how this really does kill you inside, on how this battle you are facing every single day. It drains you. It drains you, and you know what? I see it in my family member. It drains them.
Because it's not just hurting me; it's hurting those that I love that are around me, and I know that. It's very difficult on Danielle, especially because she loves me and she sees that I'm suffering, you know, at times, and. It's unfair to her, you know. It's funny because when we got, and I don't mean funny, ha ha, more like kind of peculiar, I guess. When we got married, She never signed up for this. You know, yeah, it was in sickness and the health. But again, she never signed up for someone that at the time, you know, I had my mental issues all handled. And then some things happened in my personal life, you know, all dealing with deaths of people that were incredibly close to me. And I went through an addiction problem that I overcame. But then I started, you know, having issues mentally, and that's where I seen it was hurting Danielle. And so I did what I shouldn't have done, but thankfully she pushed back. I tried pushing her away, and, you know, she's like, you know, no, MF-er, you know, you're married to me. This is, you know, I'm here with you through goodness and, you know, through good and bad, you know, sickness and in health. And thankfully she stuck by me. And that's good, because honestly, if she didn't, I almost certainly would be dead.
It's a challenge to deal with a family member every day, Danielle, in regards to mental health. Since you've had to work through this battle, what is your advice to families that need to kind of work through with a loved one that is dealing with mental illness? What can they do to be supportive of anybody who's dealing with mental illness?
Well, the most difficult part for me is, because I too have suffered from depression and anxiety and things like that, I can see both ends. Like, I know what it's like to be in that pit of despair, and so I understand why he feels so alone, and then he wants to be alone, and he doesn't want to do anything, and he doesn't want to talk about it. But I also know that you need to talk about it. You need to get out of the house. You need to get up and move around. And it's a balancing act with me and Mark. I have to kind of decide, well, what day is the right day to let him sit and be alone, and what day is the right day to go, no, we're gonna go do something outside in the sunshine. What day do I just leave him to either, you know, listen to music or play video games? Or what day do I say, no, you're going to tell me right now what's going on in your head? It's very difficult. Anyone who knows anyone, whether it's a friend, a family member, a spouse, you know, brother, sister, whoever it is, if you're dealing with someone with mental illness, you have to have empathy. You're not going to get through this without understanding what it's like. And if you've never gone through it, it's very difficult to understand. It's like, you know, Mark made the toilet bowl reference that, you know, you're drowning and you can't get out. I mean, that's a good metaphor for it. You know, I say pit of despair. You know, you don't see an end to it. And the hard part is even when you are in good times, it's always in the back of your head that it's not going to last. On a grander scale, I'm one of those people who always has empathy for everyone, people, animals, you know. This world needs more empathy. We need to treat all human beings like human beings. We need to treat animals with the respect that they deserve and the care that they deserve. You know, I just need more kindness in this world.
As always here, and not just talk about the podcast, you're always welcome on the podcast, but as I said before, this is family, and at any time, the door is open, and I always invite you in, my friend.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I appreciate it. And like I said, I hope this helps anybody that might be suffering from mental illness. Please get help.
And I do really hope you know how much I appreciate what you have done for me and my family in dealing with our crisis. So,
dude, by all means, like I said, it's likewise. Thank you.
When we come back, we're going to go ahead and talk about what's coming up in June. And we'll go ahead and talk about WWE. We got Money in the Bank. I guess we'll we'll put Ferrari to the test on the co-host side, and we'll go back and forth about Money in the Bank a little bit that is coming up here. We'll talk about the wild card and, of course, what's going to happen with Rocksteady. So stay tuned. And just as you know, as I'm putting up here on our screen here, as you see the logo, it's going to be moving on to show some different information that you can look up in regards to mental health awareness here on the J&J Wrestling Podcast. What we're going to do is we're going to just play a little bit of music here during our break here and let you go ahead and write down all this information if you want to look it up. We'll put some web pages down in the comments section for you so you can go ahead and look up anything you need. Stand by here on the J&J Wrestling Podcast here on Facebook and YouTube.
This is the fastest man in wrestling, Samuel C, and you're listening to J&J Wrestling Podcast.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to the J&J Wrestling Podcast here on YouTube and Facebook. Once again, thank you very much for joining us. I am here with, technically, he's Outbreak Representative, Marc Mandrake. Yes, he is also the Suicide Messiah and the reigning Rocksteady Heavyweight Champion. Also here with his wife and my future co-host, No, I did not get down on bended knee, because if I did, I would not get back up. The incomparable legend, Ferrari. And we appreciate you always having having you guys on the show. It's just amazing, you know, some of the dynamics here. And you know what? I want to, first of all, remember something, James. It was my idea to have the Suicide Messiah on the show. I'm the one who invited him. And since then, he has been on this show three times. It's a three-peat.
Yeah, he didn't really like me very much. Oh.
Yeah, well, you know what? He should not have been playing up to the fact that there was shenanigans, was it?
Yeah, shenanigans was a word he used.
Shenanigans.
Shenanigans was a word he used.
Speaking of shenanigans.
Yes.
What's up with you and fantasy? Here we are now. The two of you have made this match stop dead in its tracks. One was because of the Cuban flag that happened at PWE3.
Yes.
And here at Rocksteady 1, PWE4, whatever, as the Cuban assassin would say, whatever.
Right, yeah. Yeah,
whatever. That must be the Cuban rhetoric. It's starting to get to me, apparently.
That's the Cuban rhetoric. Yeah. Confused communist propaganda.
Nevertheless, you and Fantasy start going at it, and what is up?
Fantasy and I have had an issue for years.
A long time.
These 2019 is not the first time that Marc Mandrake and the Cuban Assassin have been in the ring against each other.
It was 8 years ago.
So, yeah, it all started then. You know, she gets involved. I'm in there to support him, so I go after her. And, of course, you know, at that point, things get thrown out. At PWE3, she grabbed the Cuban flag, got involved, went ahead and low-blowed Marc. So I turned around and low-blowed Cuban, you know, eye for an eye, low blow for a low blow.
That's the safer way to say it.
We'll be family-friendly.
No. Balls for balls.
Yeah,
go ahead.
Balls for balls, you know. But, you know, even in their video promo before May 11th, leading up to the show, she's threatening me. If I get, you know, Ferrari gets involved, you know, you better watch out. I don't start this. I'm there to support the Suicide Messiah, Marc Mandrake. I'm there to make sure that shenanigans don't happen.
You're welcome, James.
And it's a good thing I am there, because
yeah,
she's out there. And, I mean, I can't trust her. The fans don't trust her. Mm-hmm. You know? So it's a good thing that I'm there, and it's something that we're just gonna have to take care of, you know.
Yeah, I can't say when the match is gonna take place, only for the fact that we were hoping
Cuban
for June.
And Fantasy are on the run.
we couldn't necessarily get them to agree for June, but I know Commissioner. Trying very hard to agree to something I put forward to him, which was, an intergender match. And there's really only one way to handle this, which is an intergender match. You know, myself and Ferrari versus the Cuban Assassin and Fantasy. It's not about the belts anymore. I think even Cuban Assassin would agree about that. It's not really even so much about myself and Cuban Assassin. It's about Ferrari and Fantasy. And they seem to, you know, obviously have an issue, and I strongly, you know, support Ferrari in defending me, and I'm sure Cuban Assassin strongly supports Fantasy in defending him, although she hit me first. But the fact is it now is really about them, and once they get in the ring and get their hands on each other, finally after 8 years. That's a lot of time for tempers to boil.
Well, yeah, and I mean, don't get me wrong. I respect her for standing up for her man. But there's a difference between being out there in support of and then being out there to cause chaos and cheat for, you know? Mm-hmm.
Another one of the men you support, Butch Long.
Butcher.
But here's the thing. There was somebody else in his ear that night. Justin Michaels. What is up with him trying to get in the ear of Highwayman Butch Long? The Bone Crusher seemed to be listening, too.
Let's start right here. Butch doesn't listen to anyone. Okay? Butch listens to beer. Butch listens to
beer.
Skull crushing. And Butch listens to
beer.
No, we love Butch to death. We'll always be brothers with Butch Long. You know, right now we're not doing the Highwayman group thing, you know, I mean, but we always support each other. I trust Butch to make his own decisions.
Do you feel that, I mean, that was a very serious conversation that Justin Michaels was putting in front of Butch about how it wasn't about the Highwaymen, how it was, it needed to be about Butch. Like, as he put it, he said it's about Mark. That's what it's about right now. It's about the Suicide Messiah, not the Highwaymen.
Let me just say, if I was not yet aligned with Butch Long, I would want to be aligned with Butch Long. He's a veteran of this business. He knows what he's doing. He kicks ass. You know, I mean, why wouldn't you go after somebody like Butch Long? So I don't have an issue that Justin Michaels is trying to go after him, just the way that he's doing it, the way that he is. It's almost like he's trying to drive a wedge between us, and we've known Butch for so long that he knows, because there's been times when we've elevated Butch above Mark, you know? I mean, it's just whatever's best for the situation, so... I see the conniving that the string bean, oh, I'm sorry, the voice, Justin Michaels, is doing here, but, I don't know, Mark, do you have anything that...
I mean, here's the thing, you know, Butch Long and myself, you know, along with Ferrari, Star Stevens, at one point, Donnie York, you know, you know, we were the Highwaymen. We decided to do that, and Butch and myself, especially as far as you know, tag teams. I mean, we've captured titles in numerous promotions in the past, and you know that didn't happen just because of me. It didn't happen just because of Butch. You know, and I gotta agree with Ferrari. I mean, you know, look, if I was Justin Michaels, I would go after Butch too. You know, I can say I've tagged with Butch. I've been in the ring against him. I mean, hell, there's been times where we've had to fight over a case of beer. And I can say honestly that there's very few people that I've been in the ring with that hit as hard as Butch does. But I think it's going to work itself out. I think Butch is going to see to reason. I mean, again, while we haven't totally pushed on the Army of Darkness quite as much, you know, because Snake Master Jeff has not been able to necessarily make it up here because he's handling business down in Miami. That still is something that's very strong. Butch is still very much a part of that. And I think it's going to work itself out. You know, as far as Justin Michaels goes, you know, I don't know why he's doing what he's doing. I mean, he's already got Adi Valu. And again, I would say Adi is definitely by far one of the toughest guys, you know, on the Rocksteady roster. The only thing I could think of is he's trying to build up, with some of the toughest guys he has. He knows he's not going to be able to get me. He knows he's not going to be able to sway me, which is interesting. You would think he actually would, because me and Adi actually have history because of how close I am with the Anoa'i family, you know, which he's a part of, you know, but. You know, it is what it is, and we deal with it as it comes along. I think everything's going to work itself out, though. I don't see Butch joining up with Justin.
Real quick, since you mentioned about the Anoa'i family, I want to quickly give a shout-out to a man who brought you into the Florida wrestling, and that would be one Samu. As you know, the former head shrinker has been dealing with some with cancers, I believe of the liver it was.
Yes.
He is on the list for a transplant. Nevertheless, they're doing a special show late at the end of the month up in Pennsylvania to support Samu, to get some fundraising for him to be able to get that transplant. So we wish you the best of luck, Samu. Hopefully you will get that transplant and come to a full recovery. You definitely a tremendous athlete, great mind of the business.
I do want to throw out there, I believe that show, and you could check through WXWC4, I believe it's May 29th, and the WWE is helping out with that show as well. That show is going to be an awesome show. Yeah. And if I was up there, I mean, besides going because I have all of the love in the world for Samu. Samu was such a huge, huge influence and help on Ferrari and I when we first got started. I would still go to the show because that show is just going to be amazing. And I agree with you. I hope it does help with Samu so he can get the liver transplant because you couldn't meet a nicer guy. The guy's a big teddy bear.
In fact, you mentioned some of the WWE help. The United States champion, Samoa Joe, will be part of that show. So that's something you would definitely want to take a look at. If you live in the tri-state area, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Delaware area, definitely want to get out there. Allentown area is where you want to be to see WXWC4 and the WWE come together for a great cause. Speaking of WWE, my future co-host. Ready to go through Money in the Bank with me real quick? Because next week is Money in the Bank. why don't we start off with the Women's Money in the Bank ladder match, all right? Because right now, Raw, Dana Brooke.
Dana Brooke, getting her shot, man.
Finally, I want to say Alexa Bliss, the last year's winner of the Money in the Bank ladder match. Carmella from SmackDown, the first and second Money in the Bank winner.
That's right.
James Ellsworth. Mandy Rose is going to be on the show, which means that Corey Graves will definitely be down to be his perverted self, because not only is God's greatest creation going to be there, but Alexa Bliss, definitely just the heat that it makes Corey Graves melt, most certainly indeed. You know what? Why don't you read off the rest of them?
You're forgetting someone.
Yeah, I know. I'm forgetting a lot of people here. I'm having one of those
days. Yeah, I know. You hit on. So I've got the list of who's in the Women's Money in the Bank ladder.
You're
match.
Already great for this co-host position.
Alexa Bliss. Naomi.
Naomi, definitely a former SmackDown champion. Mm-hmm. Definitely in her own right is going to be a factor in that Money in the Bank ladder match. Matter of fact, I almost want to pin her as one of the favorites to win, but go ahead.
Yep. Natalia.
Natalia from the Dungeon of Calgary. I'm sorry, let me do that over again. From Calgary, Alberta, Canada. So definitely a good person to... you can't ever bet against the heart, right?
Mark's motioning. We talked about Dana Brooke. Some you want to talk about Dana?
What's up with Dana?
No.
I want to pick my favorite.
Your favorite?
Oh, who's your favorite?
Who's your favorite?
No, my favorite's gonna be Ember Moon.
Oh, well, we didn't get to her yet.
Ember Moon from SmackDown. Yes. She is a talent that came out from Booker T's school. Mm-hmm. I saw her for the first time when I did. Fell in love. I fell in love with her style. Definitely
she's
different.
Amazing.
Yeah, she. I still can't get over that top rope stunner that she does. That is definitely a star stealing.
And the only other one that we didn't talk about is Bayley.
Bayley is a former Raw Women's Champion. Beat the Queen for the title.
Mm-hmm.
She's definitely
a former Women's Tag Team Champion now.
That's right. So. Yeah, former Tag Team Champion. Real quick here, the monkey in the room here, Sasha Banks.
Sasha Banks. Let's talk about Sasha.
Yeah,
Banks.
Sasha Banks. She's been a hot topic right now. She's presently on leave right now, and going over life. I want to say she was not happy, apparently, in the backstage area about finding out she was losing the championship, or the fact that there was a split coming up between her and Bayley. It's a shame that you hear this, because we just got done talking about how the decisions that are made by the booking team, that are decided by production, are a key point in making a successful run of any company. And this is no different, especially on the E. And I just want to let you guys know here, I'm sorry. I'm having a hard time concentrating right now, because I have Marc Mandrake in the background laughing when I said, let's talk about the monkey in the room.
Laughing and drumming on the back of my chair right now. So
do you have something you want to share with us, Almighty Messiah?
Okay, look. I'm not going to go on rumor and innuendo, as Bruce Pritchard likes to say.
Something to wrestle with, brothers.
But I will say this: if any of that is true, and it looks like it is, and she didn't want to do what she was asked to do, she's not meant for this business. Please get the hell out and let the people that respect this business do their jobs for you.
I have nothing more to talk about regarding that situation. Who's your pick for Money in the Bank?
My personal favorite is always Carmella. I know most people think she's annoying, but she's got the Money in the Bank experience. And who knows, she might bring some help with her.
You picked her for the Battle Royal, and you were the only one who got it right.
Yes, under my call, she is. She is my favorite, but I will also say that I'm going to go ahead and say my wild card pick is Dana Brooke.
I you know what? I would love to see Dana Brooke get the opportunity. Right. And I want to go on record. I've seen some I went to NXT here in Pinellas County. It's held in Largo. And one of the very things that was awesome was Dana Brooke connecting with the fans around there, is going one by one and actually shaking our hands, talking with us. I actually have her signature on my NXT championship belt, along with a lot of the now current WWE stars, because it's been a while since I was collecting that. Genuine smile, genuine person, and this is even in her heel persona at the time. She's gone through a lot in life. Right. If many people do not know this, her fiance actually passed away about a year ago.
Right.
And it was a very trying time for her to get back on track. And she's been a fighter all along, and I really do hope that they give her the opportunity. The odds-on favorite really is Ember Moon to win this thing. So
honestly, anybody in this match
has an opportunity.
Has the opportunity, and I wouldn't even be mad if anybody in this match won.
Well, maybe. Well, you know what? We'll just let Corey Graves deal with that.
Well, yeah. You know, Corey. I understand
Corey. Mandy Rose.
I understand
Mandy
Corey
Rose.
Graves' obsession, but Corey Graves' obsession is kind of ruining, I think, some of the women's superstars. Because, can I just say this?
Hey, Uncle Jerry.
Yeah, exactly. Let me say this. At this point, they're no longer called divas. They are women's superstars. Mm-hmm. And as much as I grew up in the Attitude Era and puppies and DX and all that, and bra and panties matches, we're past that now.
Yes.
They're athletes.
Yes.
You know, I
understand. I'll be honest with you, they always were athletes.
We talked about characters earlier, and I understand that Corey Graves, that's his character on commentary, but I don't appreciate a lot of the comments that he makes about any of the women. Mm-hmm. You know, and knowing how this business works, and I know he's playing a character, and I know that, yeah, it's like the Jerry Lawler character, but I want to see these women be taken seriously, and some of the things that he says takes away from the athleticism.
Two things. Number one, he is young. And number two, he ain't no Jerry Lawler, which is why it doesn't work. Okay,
he's moving along. As young as you think he is.
No, he's not. But he's, once again, he's still...
Mark known him for a long time.
No Jerry Lawler.
Yeah.
We used to wrestle for the same promotions up in Pennsylvania and stuff like that, so...
All right, so... let's go into the championship matches real quick here regarding the women. Let me rephrase that. Both of them involve Becky Lynch because she is the reigning She's a reigning Raw and SmackDown women's champion. Now, of course, the Raw Women's Championship, she will be defending against newcomer Lacey Evans, who has shown that she has one devastating right hand. The women's right.
The women's right. That's right.
Who's your pick for that one?
I'll tell you, both women's matches, I'm picking the man, Becky Lynch, because I think she can do it, and I think she deserves to stay both women's champion. And kudos to her for wrestling twice on a pay-per-view. You know, first of all, there's not many people who are willing to do that. And not many people who are able to do that.
Yeah, there's not many people. I mean, you know, we talk about tournaments and stuff like that that have happened in the past. WWE has had the King of the Ring tournament on multiple occasions. Now, back in the day, it was all in one day.
Right.
One night. You had eight men. They would go into it. And the last man standing was the winner. Right now, you don't see a tournament style anymore. I personally like tournaments when it was needed. Eventually, we're going to be coming into the tournament for the Internet TV Championship of Rocksteady. So that is something that's coming up nearby. We have our first entry into it. We'll get more into that next weekend.
Yes.
But nevertheless... going two times in one night. Now, she's doing something for the first time in history. Nobody in history in WWE has defended two separate championships in one night.
That's right. And
that is the first time that it's going to happen.
She has so much momentum behind her.
That there's been a man, there's been two men that have challenged for in two separate matches for a champion, for two different championships. One is Rowdy Roddy Piper, Royal Rumble 1992. He challenged for the Intercontinental Championship, won that belt from Jacques Rougeau as the Mountie, and then later on competed in the Royal Rumble, which was for the WWF Championship. And of course, Razor Ramon, who challenged for the tag team championship in your house with the 1-2-3 Kid against the Guns, and then later on went and challenged Dean Douglas. God, I felt bad for Shane having to deal with that gimmick, and defeated him just 11 minutes after he was named champion because of Shawn Michaels' injury.
Right.
Nevertheless, that's the one of the few times that there has been two championship matches for the same person, but this is the first time somebody's defending the title twice. So this is a big thing for Becky Lynch. She's going to make history for not only just women's wrestling, but for wrestling in general in the WWE. Who's your pick for these? You said for both.
I'm picking Becky for both.
Becky lose her one of her championships to the Money in the Bank winner?
Well, that's always a possibility because at least one of these women's championship matches is probably going to be after the ladder match. So there's always the possibility that the winner of the ladder match could then get themselves involved in whichever championship match is later on in the night. So that's always a possibility. But I'm, you know, I'm just going to hold steady with Becky. That's what I'm doing.
Okay. Roman Reigns will be taking on Elias.
Ladies and gentlemen, Elias.
Hello, I am Elias. Not really, but you know what? Yeah, it sounded good.
It sounded good at the time.
There we go. All right.
I'm actually excited about this match because I've always been a huge fan of women and cruiserweights and the athleticism, but you can't take away from two big, strong guys who are, you know, on Roman Reigns' side, former heavyweight champions, and with Elias, I see him as a former heavyweight champion, or a future heavyweight champion, at least contender, if not hold the championship at some point. I mean, I know a lot of people are like, oh, his gimmick is a novelty thing, but you know what? How did Triple H start again?
I think he was a lackey for some guy named Shawn Michaels. But even before that, I don't know, something about Terror Rising.
Terror Rising.
I personally like the American Aristocrat Hunter Hearst Helmsley. I thought that was an awesome gimmick back in the day. Times change, and later on, he told everybody to suck it.
Right.
Okay, so there we go with that one. Speaking of cruiserweights, the cruiserweight championship's on the line. The new champion is my big surprise, I want to say, because I did not think he was going to win the title at WrestleMania. Tony Nese is going to be defending the title against Aria Davari.
Oh, yeah. So, both great competitors. Why isn't that on my list?
Because
I'm not on a good list.
You're not on a good list, apparently.
I'm not on a good list.
But nevertheless, you
know
the match.
Anyways, I know who they are. And both great competitors. I personally feel like the cruiserweight division in WWE kind of fizzled out.
Let's touch on that for a moment here.
Let's talk about that.
I have this theory, and once again, this is just something that I'm going to throw out in the air. SmackDown's about ready to go 3 hours very soon when it goes to Fox, okay?
Yes.
At that point, why not see if you can strike a deal with Full Sail University where you have the most passionate fans. NXT fans are probably the most passionate fans in the WWE.
Yeah.
Let the cruiserweights go into Full Sail University and let them have their own show there. They can record 4 to 5 episodes and have them air on the thing. It doesn't need to be 205 live. Come on. Let's just put it as a cruiserweight show. And let them shine with fans that are going to care about it. I mean, you're putting them on right after you have the main event, which is, you know, Kofi Kingston as WWE champion, is getting the pops in the world, and then you're throwing the cruiserweights
on
afterwards.
A few years ago, they did that whole cruiserweight tournament, you know, where we actually had several friends who, you know, were involved in that, were on, you know, Sean Maluda, other people, you know, great competitors from all over the world. And then they started 205 Live, and it was like hype. And then it was like fizzle. And even when they have the Cruiserweight Championship on pay-per-views, it's on the pre-show. Or it's in a slot where, like, we've just had this awesome, amazing match, and, oh, here's the Cruiserweights. And everybody goes, oh, okay, it's time to go to the bathroom. Like, and it's hard because these guys want to shine, just like Mark said earlier, that, you know, everybody on the show wants to shine and show what they can do. And sometimes I feel like these guys in the cruiserweight matches do really crazy, dangerous, reckless things to get noticed. And I really do fear for some of them because it's so easy to get injured, especially when you're flipping out of the ring or doing these crazy, you know, upside down suplexes and, you know, whatever these guys are doing. So,
I mean, the good news is that there are some stars that have come out of the cruiserweight division that are now showcased on SmackDown and Raw. Most recently, Ali has gotten several WWE championship matches.
Right.
Which has definitely been a blessing. Granted, his loss of being in one of the title matches led to the Kofi Kingston rise, of course. So that's a big plus right there. I mean, even if he didn't get the opportunity, somebody got an opportunity out of that and moved forward. So that's a big thing. And Kofi is not a large man. He is just above cruiserweight weight. So
right.
Definitely something for right there to think about. And now we've heard that Cedric Alexander is going to be on Monday Night Raw, but we have not yet to see him yet. So that's going to be an interesting challenge. Mark, I want to get your take on this, and then we're going to move along the card here.
Yeah.
Have you seen on the vignettes for the Firefly Funhouse?
Yes. Yes, they're awesome. They're awesome because if you watch, you'll pick up little things.
Well, the first thing I picked up was the witch's name.
Yes.
Abby.
It's Abby. Actually, one of the first things I was hoping most people pick up and a lot of people missed, because, again, when the vignettes started showing, even before the Funhouse vignettes were showing, they were very dark. And one of the things, and I think I even pointed out to you on the phone, was go back and watch it. And watch the rocking chair and pay attention to what it's doing. It's rocking, but when it rocks, it's rocking over the neck of a stuffed rabbit.
We saw what happened with that stuffed rabbit this past week.
And again, if you watch those segments, they're awesome segments. And again, when they first came out, there was a lot of fans that are, oh, this is horrible. You know, how could they do this to Bray Wyatt? You know, but if you watch it, I think people are going to be very pleasantly surprised with the turn it's going to take. I mean, again, I don't know for sure. I can only assume. But if you watch it and you pick up on the little things, I think that you're going to see the Bray Wyatt that everybody wants to see. The evil, mean, sadistic Bray Wyatt that everybody wants, you know.
I also think we will eventually see what's going to become of what was Sister Abigail.
I think you will too. I think you will too. At least I hope so. You know, I mean, it definitely seems like it's going in that direction. But again, they're doing what, and this is something that again, when we talk about film and wrestling and stuff, it's tiny little things that make all the difference in the world. And if you watch those, they're just tiny things that if you don't pay attention, you're going to miss. Mm-hmm. But once you see it, everything takes a whole totally different perspective for you then.
And just real quick here, I'm going to throw this at you, Mark, and see if we can get the right answer. Where can we get those awesome Suicide Messiah shirts that you and Ferrari are wearing?
Right now, you want to definitely go to a Rocksteady Wrestling Show. We will have them available.
You can also get them at the Suicide Messiah RS, by the way.
Instead of a big giant giraffe, we have a drunk lemur that stands out front.
There you go. I'm looking forward to this match.
Which one?
At Money in the Bank. Shane McMahon versus The Miz inside the confines of a match that nearly ended your career, sir. Mark.
Yeah.
A steel cage match.
Now, personally,
of course, it was The Ring who actually almost did that, but we're going to go to that one.
Personally, I've loved Shane McMahon since I was a kid. I've loved The Miz since he broke out on his own. You know, I mean, I was a fan of him as a tag team with Johnny Nitro, too, but since he's been on his own, just the Miz persona, you know, and for the first time, seeing him as a babyface, as a good guy, is really interesting. I'm definitely looking forward
to this match. It's definitely by design, obviously, because they want to promote Miz and Mrs.,
which is the funniest show I have ever seen in my entire life. Hilarious. Maurice's mother is beyond comprehension. I love Marjo. even Mandrake laughs during the show.
I want to go on record that a mere 8 years ago, I was ridiculed and scorned because I actually picked The Miz to win the main event of WrestleMania 27.
Yes.
I was right. Okay, moving along here. The WWE Championship is on the line. Kevin Owens challenging Kofi Kingston.
That should be a very interesting match.
That's going to be a hard-hitting match, I think. I think Kevin Owens is going to get a good amount of shine. I do see Kofi Kingston retaining the championship here.
Yes.
I want to say something here. First of all, Let me phrase it. Unless your name was Stevie Wonder, you should have saw it coming. I actually didn't think it was going to last 2 weeks that Kevin Owens was going to turn on the New Day. It went 2 weeks. Good stuff. You should have saw it coming. He turned on his best friend. Yeah. Not only 2 hours into his debut, he turned on his best friend. Does that tell you anything about Kevin Owens, folks?
He has a track record.
He has a track record. and you know what? You know, granted, we all like the... I like Kevin Owens. I think he's an awesome competitor. He doesn't meet the mold of a WWE superstar, but he has broken that mold. And it's definitely a standout character in the WWE who makes you turn your head to see what's going on in that ring. He's a phenomenal athlete at 266 pounds. He's not a muscle bound, but I'll tell you right now, he can do more moves than some 303-pound former WWF champion that everybody loved could do, which was just, he did drop the leg drop. I see Kevin Owens at 266 doing a move that a 205 Eddie Guerrero was doing altogether when that was a frog splash. Not a knock on Hulk Hogan, because Hulk Hogan was definitely a phenomenal athlete. And if you haven't seen Hulk Hogan actually wrestle, because I know a lot of you want to say, oh, Hulk Hogan, he can't wrestle, go watch some of his matches from when he was in Japan. That boy can wrestle. And by the way, if you're trained by Mr. Matsuda, guess what? You know how to wrestle. If you're trained by the Wild Samoan Afa, you know how to wrestle. Do I have any questions here? If you're trained by the right person, everybody knows how to wrestle. And know what? Sideshow proved that when he wrestled ERA, because quite honestly, I thought Sideshow was going to go in there and just beat the living out of him. And guess what happened? They wrestled. It was an awesome match. So, I mean, that's a very big thing here. But yes, Kevin Owens definitely is going to shine, but it will be Kofi Kingston who will retain the championship, in my opinion. The men's Money in the Bank ladder match is the next thing we're going to talk about here.
It's going to be chaos.
Chaos is the word of the day. We talked about Ali earlier. Ali has an opportunity here. I think a lot of the smaller guys have an opportunity to get up that ladder quicker.
Yes.
Unfortunately, their height is also going to be detrimental because of how high the ladder has to be. We'll get to that in just a few moments here. Finn Balor, the Intercontinental Champion, from SmackDown, he's going to be in that match. Of course,
he's got a really good chance of winning that match.
Once again, Andrade. Mm-hmm. I would love to see if Zelina Vega will get involved on his behalf here. I'm beginning to see a trend here. Okay, we talked about there was one match where Ted DiBiase Jr. was in the Money in the Bank ladder match, and Maurice just
pulled this out of my mind.
Really?
Yeah. I was just gonna say Maurice.
Climbing the ladder. Guerrero climbing the ladder for Dolph Ziggler.
Or Lita. Yes. Climbing the ladder.
Yes. And then there was James Ellsworth. Yes, him climbing the ladder.
Yeah, if you
he to. Actually legitimately won the match for Carmella.
He did.
Yes. I think that could be an interesting factor here. And regarding Zelina Vega climbing the ladder. Okay, let's get this one out of here so that way I don't have to mention his name again. The Charisma Vacuum, Baron Corbin. All right. former WWE champion, the 13-time champion, Randy Orton, is in this match, and he has won Money in the Bank before and has cashed it in and successfully. Mr. Monster in the Bank, Braun Strowman, he won the Money in the Bank contract last year. Thanks to the Shield, did not get that job done.
Yes.
Ricochet. Now, this is going to be a highlight reel with Ricochet on ladders. I'm going to tell you that right now.
He's going to be on all the highlight reels.
My pick for this men's ladder match, I have stated numerous of times since I started this podcast back with James in December that Drew McIntyre will be champion by the time 2019 is over. This is where it's going to start. Right here at Money in the Bank. That's my pick for the Money in the Bank ladder match.
I can definitely see it. I was going to say, though they are not my favorites, Drew McIntyre is one pick, and you called him the charisma vacuum, and I agree, but he has been on a roll.
He's a former Money in the Bank ladder match
Corbin
winner, unfortunately, too, yes.
But
that's back when he wasn't a charisma vacuum, because he actually had hair, and it looked like he was wrestling. Okay,
there you go. And he didn't have a dress shirt on. Anyways.
You know what sucks about Baron Corbin?
Everything?
Except his theme song.
Oh, yeah. That's true.
He has an awesome theme song. Doesn't belong, shouldn't belong to him, but he has an awesome theme song.
Yeah.
Universal Championship will be on the line.
This is going to be a match.
Scary. And this is, I believe correctly, I went and looked through. I just tried to see if I saw any Tyler Black versus AJ Styles matches in the past, and did I find one? No.
No.
This is a first time match.
How long was AJ Styles in TNA or Impact? You know, I mean, it's been a long time that AJ was like the mainstay of TNA. Seth Rollins, Tyler Black, you know,
was mainstay of ROH at the time.
Mainstay of ROH. You know, so they never got to cross paths. You know, and that's the great thing about having AJ Styles in WWE the last couple of years is there's all of these people that either most of the fans didn't get to see him against, or it's never happened before.
Yep.
So, I mean, that's one that I'm definitely looking
forward to. Another first time match here. This is going to be fun. This is actually going to be Seth Rollins' first major title defense on pay-per-view here. He had hit title defense with Kofi Kingston before that was rudely interrupted. But nevertheless, this is going to be a phenomenal match because both men can bring.
See what you did there.
Because both men could burn it down.
There you go.
There you go. See, I could get it in there. There you go. See, we're going to work this. Who'd you pick?
Oh. That's a tough one. I think Seth Rollins retains, but either through shenanigans or or just a really great back and forth match. I see this becoming a rematch next time.
Okay. Now, Mark, I know you've been sitting there patiently because we've been talking WWE. You haven't gotten to wrestling. Is this a card that you would like to watch? Would you want to watch this card?
Yeah, there's parts of it that I would watch. It's
as long as there's no UFC on that night, of course.
No, there's not. It's on Sunday. UFC was on last night. I went to it after beating Cuban. Well, okay, I didn't. It got thrown. All right, never mind. But yeah, I'll watch it. You know, again, it's one of those things where I still will watch it but I watch it in a different way than maybe you watch it or a lot of other people. I look for small things. I look for the production. I look at it different things like that because that is only going to help us out.
It's funny that you said that. They look at little things because me, I like to focus on ring announcing, and no, I don't think anybody realizes how much of a big part that is in regards to professional wrestling. Okay, how many times do I can say that I can't stand the fact when they say the following contest is a 2 out of 3 falls match? Wrong. The following contest is scheduled for the best 2 out of 3 falls. Get it right, guys, please, for the love of think.
Yeah, it's ring announcing is a lot more difficult than people give it credit for. There's a lot of things in wrestling that people think are easy when
or that don't matter.
Yeah, that actually make all the difference in the world. Ring announcing makes all the difference in the world. A good referee makes all the difference in the world.
Oh yes.
So you know, it's little things like that that do make a big difference.
You know, you talk about the commentating too, because quite honestly, Michael Cole's out there. I'm going to give him credit. I know people bitch at him all the time because of the fact that he's no Jim Ross. But I'm going to tell you something. He's not. He didn't come out here to be Jim Ross. He came out here to be the first Michael Cole, and he does a spectacular job getting talent over.
Let's face facts. Michael Cole has paid his dues throughout the years. being ridiculed and slapped around by The Rock, going out there in an orange singlet and wrestling, locking himself in a box, in a glass box. I mean...
Can I have your attention, please?
Oh, yeah. The anonymous general manager. Hey, so on this list of the matches that I found, there's... I don't know if this one's been confirmed, but I think this is going to be Mark's favorite match.
Go ahead.
Asuka and Kairi Sane versus Iconics! Oh,
God. Please, no.
That is not on my list yet, so that's why I didn't see it.
It's listed at the end as a very strong possibility on mine,
and
which
that
I think would be amazing. Or
it's possible.
Iconic. And oh wait, who picked the Iconics to win at WrestleMania?
Yeah, actually,
it was
we did.
And there's two Iconics,
which means,
and there's two of us,
which means we are Iconic.
I'm gonna stop taking my meds tonight.
Maybe that's what needed to be the new title of this show. They may be trademarks, so we have to see what we're gonna do about that.
I don't know. They are truly Iconic, so we'll pick something different. So. I think we broke the Mandrake.
We may have. I'm telling you, but you know what? It's been all in good fun here, so that's definitely something that we had to do. So, ladies and gentlemen, just a reminder: this is May's. Mental Health Awareness Month. As we talked about that. We touched on it earlier. This is something that is very serious. If you notice any of your loved ones that are being secluded to themselves, they want to talk about things. If you notice some of their moods changing really rapidly, they may need help, and you want to go ahead and get them that help. There's definitely hotlines out there. As I said, we'll go ahead and we'll put down the information we have back on our screen so you can go ahead and take a look at that. And of course, you know, there is no substitute for love. That's a lot of the big thing that can get through this. So, you know, be that friend, be that comrade, you know, that's going to pick up the phone at all hours of the night, that can go ahead and be supportive, like this family is here. So we want to encourage you to continue supporting, Mental Health Awareness Week. And you know, that, a lot of it has to depend on, not only depends on what's going on in the head, but that includes what's going on in regards to people that are African American, so race,
right.
You know, color, gender, gender identity,
sexual orientation.
I speak of that because next week my guest is a phenomenal athlete. Somebody who can get in there and kick ass with not only the women in the ring, but the men in the ring. And you know what? He or she, however you want to identify her with, stands out proudly. Jamie Senegal is going to be on the show. I am very proud of this talent who can go out there and be himself, herself, you know, however she wants to identify it. I'll tell you right now, phenomenal athlete. I saw a match between Jamie and Kylan King about a month ago that really did steal the show at the GCW event. It was a phenomenal match, a great talent. We're going to have Jamie on the show next week. It's going to be a great show. I did talk to the Technical Alchemist, David Mercury. We are getting something scheduled in the beginning of June. He won the poll to be on the show. So we're looking forward to having him on the show very soon. And of course, we're all roads are leading to, of course, July, when we're going to be showing this wonderful face, hopefully by then. Of course, card is subject to change, but we will get this face out on TV soon. Okay. Keep back with us. We're going to see if we get something lined up for the Memorial Day weekend show. That's going to be coming up. And, of course, I still plan on having a birthday bash. Yeah.
Yes, definitely. Because you're younger than me.
But you know what? I'm hitting that new mark of 40 years old. So it's definitely going to be. Ladies and gentlemen, I know it's been a long evening with us here. We are rapidly approaching 2 hours here. So let's get going here. Let's call it a night here. I want to thank my guest, Marc Mandrake, for being on here. Thank you for being so open. That's very trying to get out your emotions regarding mental health out on the air. Even just talking about it in general is a tough subject. So we thank you for doing that. We look forward to the changes for Outbreak Entertainment. And Ferrari, I appreciate you. James. You have definitely, you're hired, okay?
Oh, okay. Hooray! Can I just add to the mental health thing? You know, you did a really great job just now saying, you know, check on your friends and your family members that are down. I just want to add, check on your friends and family members that seem happy as well.
Mm-hmm.
Especially if they had been down. You know, I don't like to, like, glorify celebrity deaths or anything like that, but there was a post going around social media that, you know, check on your happy friends because, like, Robin Williams,
yep,
one of the best comedians of all time, ended up killing himself, you know? And that's, I mean, a lot of times people who have suffered from depression and mental illness will come across as improving and better, and really that's when they have the energy to actually go ahead and do what we don't want them to do, which is harm themselves. So always keep track of those that you care about and be there for them through all of the ups and downs.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You made it, champ.
I appreciate it. Thank you for everything. And like I said, again, hopefully, you know, especially, I mean, yes, we want to talk about the business aspect of Outbreak Entertainment and the future, you know, but to me, probably the most important part of this show was about the mental health awareness. And I really hope that, you know, if there was, you know, if there's anybody listening, that it does definitely help them or help family members or friends of theirs in some way. I mean, that's the big thing for me that I think was the most important part of the show.
So next week, we'll have Jamie Senegal on the show. And until then, I want you all have a fantastic evening. And we'll see you next week here on the J&J Wrestling Podcast on Facebook and YouTube. Peace out.